And I have this on the podium tonight. If someone knows who's supposed to fill it out, I appreciate it. I'm not sure exactly who formally the one who does it. Last Wednesday night, you may recall, we started by Michael telling us about a bag he was given. And inside that bag were some cookies. And at the end of the class, he pointed at me and he says, like this. And just about that time, he reaches over and picks up the bag. And I thought he was going to share his cookies with me. As it turns out, he gave me something much sweeter. He didn't share the cookies, but he gave me the opportunity to stand here before you tonight and tell you our conversion story. To tell you how the Lord in His mercy directed us and guided us to come to the knowledge of His holy word. To leave a denominational theology behind and to follow in the ways of the Lord. And I want to, as these sheets are being handed out, call your attention to the first sheet, Our Journey, Catholicism to Christ. And I gave you these sheets, excuse me, as points of reference because we cannot possibly cover everything on these handouts in the time we have allotted. So I wanted you to take that back and have it as ready reference as the opportunity provides itself. But the reason I wanted you to have this is somewhere along the way you're going to interface or meet or discuss God's Word with a Catholic. And my wife and I were both raised Roman Catholic. She was raised in Italy, just about 300 miles south of Rome. The Monsignor of her parish was a regular visitor to her house. The Monsignor knew her and her family very well. And in fact, her grandfather was the custodian for the church. He played the organ and he served as an altar boy. So she was highly involved in Roman Catholicism. Her whole family was and remains so much of that to this day. In my case, I was raised in Brooklyn, and I attended a parochial school and was taught by nuns until I graduated from the 8th grade and went on to high school. And then I went to a public high school and kind of separated from the nuns' instructions. But while I was a young man growing up, I served as an altar boy. And as I got older and more experienced, I trained younger boys to also serve at Mass at the altar. And during that time, as I was serving as an altar boy, I started thinking, you know, this is a calling that I maybe should consider fulfilling full-time in the priesthood. And so I actually created a miniature altar in my bedroom. And I would practice serving the Mass in my bedroom, and I'd repeat the Latin scriptures over and over again in verses that were supposed to be used during the Mass, because I wanted to make sure I did it right. And then as I got a little older, I started to notice there were things called girls. And all of a sudden, the idea of a life of celibacy was no longer quite as interesting as it was before. And I started thinking to myself, well, certainly I can serve the Lord in other ways without being a celibate priest. And so I just continued in the best way I could to continue to serve the Lord as a good, faithful, practicing Catholic. And then in 1967, I met my beautiful wife, Elena, in England. And I was stationed there in the military, and she was studying nursing there. And she was studying nurses, and I was studying nurses, so it was a good match. And we got to know each other, and one of the first things that she made me do as we started to date was to start reciting parts of the Mass in Latin. So can you imagine the scene here? She's sitting there and said, well, I need to know you're a Catholic. And I start reciting the Confiteor, which is Confitello Deomni Potenti, Beata Maria Sempla Vigili, Beata Maria Altangelo, Beata Ioanni Baptista Zycus. And she said, that's enough. That's enough. I believe you. You're obviously a Catholic. We moved to Texas after we got married in 1967, in 1972. And we left our families behind. She left hers much further away than mine. Mine were back in Brooklyn and that general area of New York, and hers were back in Italy and England. And we started to ask ourselves questions. Because even as practicing Catholics, even having the Monsignor come to her house, even being taught by nuns and serving as an altar boy, there were always questions in my mind that just didn't make a whole lot of sense. And I wanted to know more about my faith, and I wanted to understand it better. And so, we never thought about using the Bible. And one day, we were in the supermarket, and there was this little pamphlet called Bible Golf. And it was a device that was put out in the marketplaces by the Brown Trail Church of Christ. And all you did was pick up this brochure and find a subject you were interested in. And you dial that phone number, and they would say, what tape would you like to hear? And let's say you wanted to hear about baptism. Well, they'd put that tape in the machine and tell you to listen on your phone and to write down every one of the scriptures referenced in that study tape. And then when the phone call was over, to get out your Bible and then study each verse. And then study each verse in context. And then study each verse within that chapter and that book to try to get a grasp of what it is God was trying to tell you in His holy word. And as we began to study God's word, we came to a drastic realization. Much of what we believed couldn't be found in Scripture. At the bottom of that first page, you'll notice number one on the left, infant baptism to remove original sin. And that little code on the right is N-I-N-T. That means not in New Testament. Couldn't find it. And then we try to find limbo, because in the Catholic theology, if a baby dies before it's sprinkled and its godparents pray over that baby, that little gift from God goes to a place called limbo. Limbo was a gray room, the way it was described to me as a young man. And they would spend eternity in that gray room with no hope of ever going to heaven because their original sin had not been washed away by the sprinkling of the priest. And then we looked up godparents, not in the New Testament either. And then confessions to a priest. Now that was a real tough one because we were taught as children that the only way we could communicate with God was to go into this little room where the priest sits in the middle and there's another little room to the side, and you kneel down and you tell the priest, bless me, Father, for I have sinned. My last confession was a week ago and I accused myself of the following sins, and then you go and list the things you've committed since your last confession. And then this priest listens to what you say, and then he begins to say a prayer, and then when he's all done, he'll say, go in peace, say five Our Fathers, 10 Hail Marys, and 5 Rosaries. And then you're supposed to leave and do what he has given you as penance for the sins you have committed. We also studied and found we were looking for a pope. Now, we were told that Peter was the first pope. But in Matthew 16, 15, and through 18, we find that that's not necessarily the case. In fact, when Jesus talked to Peter, when Peter confessed that he was, in fact, the Son of God, there were two words used in there that the Catholic Church has twisted around. He says, Peter, thou art the rock, the little pebble. The word he used was small stone. And then he turned around after he confessed that, Peter confessed that Jesus was the Son of God. And he said, upon this rock, this giant boulder, it's a different word in Greek, I will build my church. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And so there was a vast difference between what I was taught and what was in Holy Scripture. Peter was nothing special. And by the way, Peter had a family. And you'll notice today the Catholic Church teaches if you have to be celibate, you can't have a family. We'll talk about that more later. And then we talk about also in regards to Peter in Acts 10, 24 through 26, when Peter was in the house of Cornelius in Caesarea. He fell down before Peter. And what did Peter tell him to do? He told him to get up. Don't bow down before me. I'm a man just like you. And yet, as I was raised, you couldn't do that with the Pope. You couldn't do that with the bishop, the Monsignor, or even a priest. They were somebody special, had to have special names. Mary worship, the next one on the list, not in the New Testament. The Rosary, we'll talk about that in detail in just a moment. Was a dogma that was instituted by Pope Pius XII And that didn't happen until 1950. Well, see, I was born in 1947. And so I didn't bother to go back in history to look at what I was being taught and when it came in to Roman Catholic theology. I thought it was there from the very beginning, that the church would be the same yesterday, today, and forever. We'll talk about that some more as well. But I couldn't find the rosary in the New Testament. And then it talked about transubstantiation. We'll talk about that in more detail. And finally, purgatory. Purgatory is a place that everybody has to go, no matter how faithful a life they have lived, to burn away the effect of the sins you committed in life. And you stay in purgatory until you're released from that fiery punishment. How do you get released? Well, you have people like your family offer masses for you, offer prayers for you, and offer mass cards to have masses offered in your name, and they cost money. You make donations to the church to do that. And if you do enough of them, just maybe your loved one will be released from purgatory sooner than they would be otherwise. Well, again, there's nothing in the New Testament that talks about purgatory or buying someone out through some kind of a mass or other ceremony. And so on 4/21 of 1977, on page 2, Elaine and I had a home study with Eddie Whitman, one of the elders from the Brown Trail Church of Christ. He came by our house, and we studied for hours. And I had question after question after question. And I was confident that I'd find something he couldn't answer. But after over 4 hours of pounding questions, he did just what Jesus did when he was tempted by the devil. He turned to Elaine and I and said, "Well, it's written, let me show you." And would read scripture, and the answer to our question would be there. And so as the hours went by, it became crystal clear that we could no longer continue taking breath until we had the saving blood of Christ around us, and asked him what could we do to get baptized that very night. And so he contacted Chester Hill, the preacher at the Mayfield Road Church of Christ, just a few blocks away from where we were living. They opened up the auditorium. They got the rooms all ready. We went up, and both of us were baptized that very same night. And I'll tell you this right now, none of our families were pleased by our decision, because they didn't understand why we had done that. We tried desperately to explain it to them. But here's the thing, and this is why it's so difficult to take someone, not only a Roman Catholic, but anybody who's been raised in denominational theology. Because in the back of their mind, they're saying to themselves, "Now, wait a minute. I was taught what I believed by my mom and my dad. And certainly, mom and dad wouldn't lie to me. And their mom and dad were taught by grandma and grandpa. They wouldn't lie to them." And on and on and on it goes back through the years. And it's only when someone sits down and opens up God's Word do we find a better understanding of what we need to know. And so as we go forward, I'd like to bring some passages of Scripture into our discussion, because these are some of the ones, as we studied with Eddie, that really sunk in and helped me to appreciate the importance of doing what God wants us to do through His Holy Word. In John 17, verses 20 through 22, we read, "Neither pray I," that's Jesus speaking, "for these alone," the apostles, "but for them also which shall believe on me through their word, that they may be one." And that word is really important, because as we heard that and we read that for the first time, we realized, wait a minute, one, singular, not a multiplicity, not hundreds of thousands, but one church, one message, one Savior. And it goes on to say, "As thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us. That the world may believe that thou hast sent me, and the glory which thou gavest me I have given to them, that they may be one." There's that magic number again. Singularity. 2 Timothy 2:15 tells us to study, to show thyself approved unto God. Unto God, not to a priest, not to a bishop, not to a monsignor, not to the pope, not to a reverend, But show thyself approved unto God, a workman that need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And the only way to rightly divide the word of truth is to study the word of truth, to come to know the word of truth, to live by the word of truth, and then you'll be able to properly divide the word of truth. And in 2 Timothy 4:3 and 4, we get a warning. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears, and shall turn away their ears from the truth, and shall be turned into fables. And so if we wonder, as we're going to talk about, why there are so many denominations in the world, here's the warning right here. The time is going to come when those who hear the truth, those who know the truth, that are currently following the truth, they're going to let someone else convince them they're wrong. And they're not going to believe what they know. Much like Eve in the garden. Much like Adam in the garden. They were told by God, don't eat off this tree. Everything else is yours. But not of this tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Leave that one alone. And when the serpent talked to him, what did they say? Planted the seed of doubt. Surely God didn't say you would surely die. That's not what he said. You must have misunderstood. And they brought sin into the world. Well, that can happen to us today if we're not well-versed and well-founded in God's word. In Ephesians 4 and verse 5, here's that number one again. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. Not a multiplicity, not many, one. And that's what the beauty of God's word is. It's so simple, because there's no way to be confused if there's only one choice to make. You follow God's word and God's word alone, and your salvation is assured. But Paul saw what was happening in Galatia. And in Galatia chapter 1 and verse 8, he says, but though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. He repeats that in verse 9. So that must be an important point. And he was warning them based on what he saw and what he heard, that there were teachers coming in trying to take these people that had heard the gospel and obeyed the gospel and had followed the gospel and turn them away in a different direction back to the old Mosaic law. They were leading them astray. And Paul is saying, if anybody does that, they need to be accursed. And like Paul, who was a Jew, he lived under and followed Mosaic law. Elaine and I lived under and followed Catholic doctrine. Both of us were following the traditions of our fathers, which is just what Paul had been doing. And he was very committed to what he was doing. He was killing Christians because that's what he believed was the right thing to do. But he came to find out that was the wrong thing to do. When he came to know Christ, when he came to hear the saving grace and message of Jesus, things changed. And he turned his life around and became the most prolific writer and proclaimer of Jesus in the New Testament. When we brought our first Bible and came to know God's word, we found the narrow way that leads to this great gate as described in Matthew 7:14, and could not wait to be baptized into Christ. And the reason I wanted to bring this lesson tonight and get it on video so we could put it on the church websites is that hopefully somebody who's in a denomination will listen to it with the love that is being delivered, not because I want them to follow what I have to say, because what I have to say doesn't mean a thing, but I want them to study God's word, to open up the book like Elaine and I opened up the book, and find the wonderful saving message of Jesus Christ. It's there. All you've got to do is let God direct you through the Holy Spirit and you'll find it. And be clear, though some people say, oh, you guys in the Church of Christ think you're the only ones that are going to be saved and you're judging me and telling me. No. Not at all. There's one judge. He was nailed to the cross at Calvary, and he will return in God's good time, and he will be the one and only judge. And all of us will appear before him. But when I see something that the scriptures tell me is not correct, I then have an obligation as a child of God to point that out, to stand up for it and to preach it and to teach it, so just like Jesus told us, lost souls might be saved. That's why we follow the teachings of the New Testament. Now, the other handout you have is the Roman Catholic Church history and doctrine. And in Hebrews 13 and verse 8, we're told that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Well, if he's the same yesterday, today, and forever, so is what he taught. So is what his word teaches. And it's up to us to bring that forward. And we're warned also in verse 9 of Hebrews 13, be not carried about with diverse and strange doctrines. That's where denominationalism came from. Diverse and strange doctrines. And let me show you, for example, the summary of the Catholic Church. Now, it starts out at the top of the apostasy, which began in 325 AD. Emperor Constantine decided back in 325 that he wanted to be a Christian. And so he brought all the local religious bodies together in Nicaea. And they had this council. And during that council, they established doctrines and synods and canons and orthodoxy and created the universal church, designed to bring in all the other religious theologies into this one central body under one central head. But notice underneath something I never knew in my 30 years of being a Catholic. I thought everything in this list was from the very beginning. Because again, God's the same yesterday, today, and forever. So why isn't his doctrine and his teaching in this church the same yesterday, today, and forever? Well, look at the dates of these things. The Latin Mass didn't even come into existence until 394 AD. And then in 431, they brought in worship of Mary, the mother of Jesus, as if she was someone holy and sacred and worthy of veneration. And then came the doctrine of purgatory in 593. Look at this, in 606, 600 years after Christ and after Peter, now we have the office of Pope. What did they do in those first 600 years? Why did it take 600 years to decide we need to have this head, this overseer of all the other priests? And then in 788, we have worship of the cross and images and relics. And if you've ever been to St. Peter's Basilica, you're going to see something really strange. And even when I was there the first time as a Catholic, it struck me strange. But there's a big statue of Peter on a pedestal. And the followers of Catholicism wait in line for one purpose. They want to kiss the toes of that statue. That statue made by the hands of man, people wait in line for hours to touch and to kiss and to pray before, as if that statue has some kind of superpower. But you know, that's not what the New Testament teaches, is it? That's not what's in Scripture. God is not material. Communication with the Father isn't done through things made by the hands of man. In fact, even the second commandment told us not to create any graven images. And yet when you go to Rome, that's all you can find. There's graven images on the top of the building, at the bottom of the building, on the walls of the building, inside the building, in alcoves all around the building. And each one has a different purpose, and we'll talk about saints in just a minute. But we're not supposed to worship images, because what is God? God isn't physical. God is spirit. And we're commanded to worship him in spirit and truth. Not by going in front of a thing made by the hands of man and lighting candles and saying prayers. That piece of marble or that piece of bronze can't do a thing for us. Only the Son of God, who went to the cross of Calvary, who bought our salvation through his blood and his sacrifice, can help us. No one else. Holy water came in 850, celibacy of priest in 1079. So up until then, you didn't have to have no family. You could have a wife and children. But then the Pope in 1079 came along and said, nope, don't like that anymore. Priest's going to have to be celibate for the rest of their lives. Then we have prayer using the rosary in 1090, the sale of indulgences, which we'll touch on in just a moment, doctrines of transubstantiation, which we'll also touch on in a moment, confession to a priest, 1,200 years after Christ, now we have to go into a room and tell our sins to another man. And then this man prays to God on our behalf, because we can't do it ourselves. And then he grants us penance for the sins we've committed. That's not in the New Testament. That's not in the teachings of Jesus in any way, shape, or form. When he was talking to his disciples and he taught them to pray, he didn't say, go to this man and offer this prayer. He said, pray like this: Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, for thine is the power and the kingdom and the glory. But I have to go to this man in this room to be able to get that communication to the Father. That's just not what the New Testament teaches. In fact, if you notice, underlined in bold print, 1229, the Bible was forbidden by papal dictate. Because you and I didn't have the training and the skill and the ability to read God's Word. You had to be someone who was a priest, someone who was blessed by someone higher up in the priesthood to say you are now qualified to learn how to study God's Word. The common man couldn't understand it, couldn't follow it, and couldn't be saved through it. Sprinkling replaced immersion in baptism in 1311. Replaced immersion in 1311. So for 1300 years, it was okay to immerse. But there was a circumstance that came up where one of their special individuals couldn't be immersed, so they sprinkled them, and that started the whole new tradition, and it lives on to this day. Purgatory came into existence in 1439. Pope Infallible in Doctrine in 1870. 1931, Mary was declared not as the mother of Jesus, but as the mother of God. In AD 1950, we were told that Mary no longer stayed in the grave. It was declared by the Pope that her body was taken physically from that grave and carried by angels to heaven, and that she sits at the hand of God and prays on our behalf. Papal infallibility, that next paragraph, talks about the fact that the Pope has the power and the authority as the vicar of Christ on earth, Christ's replacement, if you will, on earth until he comes back, makes statements, and when he makes statements and he is speaking in what's called ex cathedra, or in the chair, that's God speaking directly through his lips, telling us what we must not or must do. And that's where all these additional universal doctrines came from. Some pope sat in the chair and said, aha, God just told me we have to be celibate. God just told me we have to worship Mary as the mother of God, not the mother of Jesus, and so on. And so I want people, as they listen to this tape, if they do, to get out their Bibles and study the Word of God and see, can you find any of that in there? And I can tell you right now, you cannot. It's not there. You'll find it in your catechism. You'll find it in your St. Joseph's Daily Missal, but you will not find it in God's inspired Word that has stood through the centuries. And then at the very bottom, you'll notice this summary of denominations. All of these are offshoots of the Catholic Church coming into existence in 325. And 1 Corinthians 14:33 tells us that God is not the author of confusion. Well, if I don't want to be confused, and I look at this list, how do I know which one to choose? Look at the list. We have Roman Catholics, Anabaptists, Lutherans, Church of England, Calvinists, and Presbyterians, Baptists, Amish, Methodists, Adventists, Disciples of Christ, Southern Baptists, Seventh-day Adventists, and so on. And within those groups, there's subgroups. Is that confusing to anyone? But yet God tells us he's not a God of confusion. Remember when we first started with John 17? That the relationship was one-on-one. Jesus was one with the Father, and his disciples were one through him with the Father as well. Singularity, simplicity, clarity. Because the warning comes in James 3:16, for where envy and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work. You know, the Lutheran Church came into existence because Martin Luther, a Catholic, was unhappy with the fact that the Pope that he served was selling indulgences. And we can go over to the next page and we can touch on indulgences here, two pages back. Well, page 3. Indulgences, there are two kinds. Down there on line 4, partial and plenary. A partial indulgence removes part of the punishment for your sins, and a plenary indulgence removes all of the punishment of your sins. And then in that second paragraph on line 4 to the right, it says, the power and propitiation of Christ is replaced by that of the Roman Catholic Church. In other words, the indulgence makes the sacrifice of Christ on the cross of no effect. Because if you commit a sin and you pay the price, the priest will say a prayer, beep, it's all taken care of. Your sins are forgiven. Why do we need the blood of Christ if that's the case? And that's why Martin Luther was so angry. And that's why he nailed his thesis to the church house door. Because he didn't believe the New Testament taught that you can buy your way out of sin. And you know what? He was right. You can't buy your way out of sin. The only way your sins get washed away is how? The cleansing blood of Christ. That's it. You can't buy anything to remove sin. And then if you go to the next page, the Assumption of Mary, look at number 6 on that list. These are statements taken right out of the catechism. And it says, her body, as well as her soul, is taken up into heaven. Along with the other 9 items on the list. But that one really is the one that kind of gets me. Because if you look down there in the next section, the coronation of Mary, look at number 2. Mary is crowned by her divine Son as the Queen of heaven and earth. Look at number 6. Mary shares so fully in the glory of Christ because she shared so fully in his suffering. Where can you show me in the New Testament that Mary was flogged, beaten, scourged, spat upon, nailed to a cross? Where do you read that about his earthly mother? The answer is you don't, because it's not in the New Testament. And it goes on to say that, in number 8, the angels and the saints longed for the coming of her whose heel crushes the head of the serpent. Wait a minute, my Bible doesn't teach that she, her heel, did anything. That was Jesus. But that's what they teach. And finally, number 10, a great sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, the moon under her feet, and on her head a crown of 12 stars. New Testament passage, chapter, verse, anyone? Doesn't exist. And so as you listen to this tape, whoever may be listening to it, get out your Bible and find that. If you can find it, you can call me, 214-682-7234. I'll be glad to study with you and help you to understand God's plan for your soul's salvation. In the middle of this, we have the rosary. Now, the rosary is a device that's made on a basis of the Hindu beads, the Islamic beads, and the Buddhist beads. It's a prayer bead set that has a crucifix at the bottom. It has a small set of beads right above the crucifix. And then it splits up into 5 sections of 10 prayers each, separated by 1 glory bead. Now the list is right there. You have the sign of the cross. You take the cross and you bless yourself with it. Then you recite the Apostles' Creed, which I've provided for you in this handout. Then you would say, One Our Father, which is basically the quotation from Matthew 6, 9 through 13. Then you say 3 Hail Marys, then 1 Glory Be. Then you move on to the big part of the rosary. You say 1 Our Father, 10 Hail Marys, 1 Glory Be, 1 Our Father, and then you repeat that sequence 5 times. So in total, you pray to Mary 53 times. You pray to God the Father 7. You pray to the Trinity 6. You recite the Apostles' Creed 1. And you notice who's missing in all these prayers? Who has 0 prayers? Not 1 single mention of Jesus. Not 1 prayer to Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. As a Catholic, I never gave that a second thought. I was taught that Mary was my interceder. Jesus died on the cross, but he came to light because of Mary. And Mary was the one who was important. And this rosary and the number of prayers to her told us that. And she got venerated just like the coronation and the Assumption tells us above. And notice the prayer down there at the bottom under the Our Father. This is the quote, "Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God," not Mother of Jesus, Mother of God, "pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death." And then Pope Pius XII declared that she was assumed into heaven even more gloriously than Christ. And then there's "Glory be to the Father. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end." World without end. Does that sound scripturally contradictory? In 2 Peter 3:7 through 12, we're told that everything in this universe will pass away. It'll be disposed of with great noise, heat, and burned up. Not going to be here anymore. So there is no such thing as a world without end. And the other thing that I want to bring up too is that all this teaching typically came to us from priests who demanded that they be called Father. And of course the Pope is the Holy Father. I was talking with George before we started our class today, and he pointed out to me that he went to school with a couple of priests. He refused to call them Father because the Bible prohibits it. And they said, "Where is it prohibited in the Bible?" He said, "Well, let's turn to Matthew 23, verses 8 and 9, where it says, 'But be ye not called Rabbi, for one is your master, even Christ, and all ye are brethren. Call no man your father upon the earth, for one is your father.'" That's that one again. You notice that it keeps coming back. "One is your father which is in heaven." One is your father which is in heaven. This man who went to a school has not earned the right, unless he's my physical father, to be called by that name. I've only got one heavenly father, and he's the one I pray to. He's the one that Jesus said, when you pray, pray "Our Father." That's the Father in heaven, not some man who wears a collar with a little white stripe in the front, or some guy in Rome who has a big pointy hat on and holds these very big masses and brings thousands and thousands and thousands of people to the services to hear what he has to say. What he has to say is not what God has to say. And then I remember as a young boy also, I was studying under a bunch of nuns. And the head of the nuns had a very unique name. She was identified as Reverend Mother. And we know within the denominational world, there are many men who walk around and wear the title of Reverend or Right Reverend. Well, in fact, if you read the Bible, that term is reserved for one person and one person alone. There's 791,328 words, give or take, depending on your version, in the Bible. And in Psalm 111 and verse 9, this is the only time out of those 791,328 words that the word Reverend appears. He said, "Redemption unto his people. He hath commanded his covenant forever. Holy and reverend is his name." That's it. That's the only time the word reverend appears in the New Testament. The Old Testament, in the Bible as a whole. And it applies one time and one time only to the God and Father who resides in heaven, who loves us the world so much, he sent his only begotten Son, that those who believe in him and are baptized should be saved. But yet men love to wear that title, even though to do so, based on God's specific use in his inspired word, would be blasphemy. God alone is reverent, and God alone is worthy of wearing that name. And so, as we go through the balance of this, there's one more doctrine we can touch on and a couple of small points in the last few minutes. Transubstantiation, that's a big word. And that simply means that in the Catholic theology, that little white wafer that's called a host, and it's made typically by nuns or maybe even bought at the commercial factory nowadays, is held up by the priest during the Mass, and he says some words over it, and all of a sudden, miraculously, that wafer becomes the literal body of Jesus Christ. And when he raises the chalice that has wine in it, and he says some holy words, it becomes the literal blood of Jesus Christ. Transubstantiation, from one thing becoming something totally different. So if you think about that, when you're receiving communion, you're receiving the physical flesh of Jesus Christ, and you're receiving the and drinking the physical blood of Jesus Christ. But Jesus has gone back to the Father, and he now sits at the right hand of the Father. Why would man seek to go ahead and sacrifice the flesh and blood of his Son over and over and over again, and allow you and me, if we were Catholics, to partake of it? That is not a doctrine found in the New Testament. John 6:63, very clear. God is spirit, and they that worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. And in John 4:24, Jesus is God. God is spirit, therefore flesh worship. The Eucharist teaches that Jesus remains worldly flesh and blood. Christians know that his body is nailed to the cross at Golgotha, and it rose from the grave. And Paul taught in 1 Corinthians 15:42, so also is the resurrection of the dead. It is sown in corruption. It is raised in incorruption. It is sown a natural body, and it is raised a spiritual body. Transubstantiation makes Jesus once again corruptible and, worse yet, digestible. There's a major problem with that doctrine. And just as we close out, I'd like to point out a few realities. In the Catholic Church, there's approximately 10,000 named saints in their hierarchy. You offer prayers to saints. You offer prayers to Mary. In fact, one of the saints, Saint Christopher, used to be, and to some extent still is, on the dashboards of people's cars. And he was the saint of travelers. And if you're going to take a journey and go anywhere, even just to the supermarket, you look at Saint Anthony and say, watch out for me. You say a little prayer to Saint Anthony and ask him to watch you when you travel. But in 1969, it was decided, you know what? Saint Anthony really isn't a saint. He no longer qualifies to be prayed to for travel. So he was taken off the list. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Now I hope as we've gone through this tonight, but like I said, now you turn to that back page when you get home and go through all the different offices that exist within the Catholic doctrine and the Catholic Church, and review those. And if you have any additional questions, please feel free to call me. My number's on the video. And if I can help you with anybody who wants to study, especially a Roman Catholic who doesn't understand, let me help them. I'm here for one purpose only, to serve Jesus Christ, to bring the lost to the saving grace of his blood, and to help those who don't understand to do so through God's word. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that we have an opportunity, as we have tonight, to gather here in this comfortable place to reflect on the beauty, the simplicity, and the clarity of your holy word. That in the oneness that you teach, we don't need to be confused. We don't need to be lost. We can simply follow that single road, that straight gate, the narrow way to the saving grace of Jesus. Help us to be willing, ready, and able to talk with those who are lost in the teachings of men, that we might, through your guidance, your inspiration, and your direction, touch their hearts and their souls with your truth. Give us the wisdom to say the right things and the right word in the love that you have shown for us, that we must show to them. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.